a little old school on you. Anyone remember that song? Anyone in here? Nobody, huh? One? Why, because they played it earlier? Oh, two? Two people. It's old school. It's old school. It's a good song, though. It's a good song. You guys listen. Any Gaither fans in here? I'm a huge Gaither fan, man. It's great stuff. Yeah, it's just amazing stuff. Amazing stuff. Well, you guys like this? Does it look cool? Do you like it? Came out pretty good, right? I want to thank people who helped to do that. It was a lot of work, and I appreciate the hard work that went into it, and I think it worked out well. Someone's killing one of our kids. It's awesome. It's not Katie this week. It sounds like Jackson, because it sounds like a girl, so it sounds like Jackson. Well, I wore my flannel shirt because I was hoping that it would be fall, like I'm pushing it, like I have that kind of influence on God. I'm working on it, but you can kind of smell it in the air and the rustic feel in here, and I wore the shirt to kind of match, hoping it would cool down, but it's kind of hot out still, you know. I was talking to Kyle this morning. It was, you know, mid-50s. That was kind of nice, you know, mid-50s, and the leaves are starting to turn. He's wearing Jamie's sweatshirts. Yeah, yeah. You're lucky your mom's not here. You get in trouble. But anyway, it's nice and cool up there. The leaves are turning. Fortunately, I'm going to go up there and see him next week. So we're going to do some leaf peeking, and maybe Jamie will let me wear one of her sweatshirts too. Although her and I have about the same belly now. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But anyway, I'm from New England, and so I got to enjoy the weather up there. And this time of year, it's beautiful. The leaves start changing, you know. When I get up there, one of my favorite things to do is to climb Great Blue Hill. I've mentioned that place to some of you in the past. It's not like a mountain like this series here, the God of the Mountain, God of the Valley. This is not a mountain by any means. It's Great Blue Hill. It's 700 feet above sea level. So it's not like a monster, you know, but in the landscape in just outside of Boston, which is just kind of like rolling hills, but this is a big hill, and they actually ski on it, and it's not much. But it's beautiful, and I would climb up there sometimes. When I was a kid, I'd climb right up the rocks or the face, and that was challenging, but I was young, and now I'm a little bit older, so I go up the pass. There's a path. You can go some trails up there. But just sit at the top, and I don't know if anyone do any mountain climbing at all or anything like that. I mean, you guys are outdoor people, right? So you get up there, and you'll feel me. You get up there to the top, and it's just like, wow, you know, and from this hill, it's like, again, it's like a bump, but it's, for that area, it's pretty big. And you get up on top, but you can see off in the distance the skyline of the city of Boston, which is really, really beautiful, and this Houghton's Pond and Prowse Farm and all these beautiful trees, and there's still a lot of big trees up there, and the sugar maples are bursting in color, and so it's beautiful to see. And you get up there, and it's just in awe. Just absolutely gorgeous. I love going up there. My sister, actually today and yesterday, she started texting me pictures of the leaves turning. Now, my sister is evil because she knows it's not like, oh, here, check it out. She knows that this time of year, like, I've been down here for 20 plus. I am so homesick this time of year that when I see those pictures, it like almost brings tears to my eyes. I want to go up there so bad and see it. But not this year. Not this year. Although, I'm going to go to Chicago, and maybe the Leafs will be pretty then. But anyway, we're going to start this new series, and it's called, as you can see up on the screen, The God of the Mountain, God of the Valley. And I'm just going to kind of give it a subtitle here, which is Experiencing God's Presence Everywhere. Everywhere. Yeah, everywhere you go, everything you do. And really, where it came from, I was reading through the scriptures, and I actually came across this Old Testament story. It's a really amazing story. It's in 1 Kings chapter 20. I don't know if you guys want to grab a Bible and check it out with me if you want. If you don't have a Bible, there's orange and yellow ones all over this place. We'll put the page numbers to those Bibles up there as we read these verses. Not all of them will be up there, but some of the major ones will be up there, and you can reference them. But hopefully you have your own Bible. You can go ahead and look this up. But anyway, just to kind of give you an idea of what's going on in this story, which is with a jump-off point for our message series, there's a story. Israel, of course, all in the Old Testament, they're fighting with everybody all the time. They've gone over into this promised land, and of course, this is all kinds of fights in the Old Testament. So here's Israel, and they've got this king Ahab, and he's got an army, and then there's this other king, Ben-Hadad, and he's the king of Aram. And you can look up all this kind of stuff if you want and read up to that. But just to give you a summary of it, Ben-Hadad is going to go to war against Israel. And so he gathers up a big army, and they go to fight, and they lose. And Israel wins. Surprise, surprise. Right? Imagine that. So little old Israel wins yet again. And so what happens is Ben-Hadad's people, his peeps, come to him and say, "Hey, listen, that was like lucky. Okay, we're going to win. Let's just gather up another army and let's go back and we're going to beat them." Because here's the thing. They said it. It's over here in chapter 20. And I hate this, that only in the New Living Translations, which I use, do they have it wrong. All the other translations say something different, but this translation says it wrong. But it says here in verse 28, it says, "Then the man of God went to the king of Israel and said," this is what the Lord says, "the Arameans have said, 'The Lord is God of the hills and not of the valleys.'" That's a better translation. So stop there for a second. What happened was when they won the first time, the people in the opposite army, they said, "Listen, the only reason why these guys beat us is because we were on top of this mountain and their God," see, they're polytheistic people, those other people, they don't understand that we have one God that we worship, the God. That was a great amen spot. Okay, we only worship one God, the God. Okay, and so they said, "Those people, those Hebrews, they have gods that are gods of the mountain, but they're not the gods of the valley. So let's bring a new army and we'll go to the valley and we'll beat them." So this is what he says in response to that. He says, "This is what the Lord says. The Arameans have said, 'The Lord is God of the hills and not of the valleys.' So I will defeat this vast army for you. Then you will know that I am Lord." He says, "Listen, I'm the God of the mountain and the God of the valleys. It doesn't matter where you go, I'm in charge of all of it." That was another good amen spot. Okay, so here's the thing. We know that not only does this story say that, but we know that God is the creator. And so we see in Psalm 104, verse 8, it says, "Mountains rose and valleys sank to the levels you decreed." So physically, God is in charge of all creation. And I think it's in Isaiah 61, 64, somewhere on there, it says, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might shake in your presence." God is in charge of the mountains and of the valleys. Physically, he is. All creation must heed to its creator always, all the time. You know, in our country here now, how many of you guys know that we live in a Florida that's flat? Right? We notice that? You guys all notice that? It's pretty flat around here, isn't it? So what do we do? On vacations, what do? We go to the mountains. Everybody goes to the mountains, right? That's where, you know, because when you go to the mountains, right, you see it all the time. "This is God's country." You guys ever say that? Who's ever said that? "This is God's country." You put your hand down like I was going to say something wrong. Who's ever said, "This is God's country" about the mountains, right? It's common. We love the mountains. We love the mountains. Well, we go to the mountains, to the physical mountains, because we want to experience beauty and splendor, all that God is. It's awesome. And when we've gone to the mountain, like I went to Blue Hill, and you've gone to the mountains, this is God's country, because when you're up there, you experience his splendor and majesty, don't you? You do. Whoa. Hello. But since we're in Florida, you're not going to go on too many mountains when you're here, are you? Sugarloaf Mountain, yeah. Go through Astatula, that's a mountain range, right? Mount Dora, that's got elevation. Here's Mount Dora. There's it. We got on top of it right there. Yeah. But although we're not going to go to the mountains physically too often when we're here, we can go to the proverbial mountain, can't we? And we can go to the proverbial valley often. It looks kind of like this. You know, things are looking up. Up on the mountain, right? Oh, how you feeling? Oh, I'm down in the dumps. Where's that? That's the valley. I'm flying high. I'm on the mountain. Oh, I'm feeling like crap right now. I'm in the valley. I'm on top of the world, right? You might say, I'm on top of the world. And then sometimes, what is it? Oh, I feel like the world is on my shoulders, right? Anybody? Come on, right? Everybody in this room has felt like that. Back, up and down, up and down. Peaks and valleys of life. The ebb and flow, people will say. Things go up, things go down. You're either in a valley right now, you just got out of one, or you're heading into one. That's just the way it is, right? That's the way it is. Well, the mountaintop experience, we're all looking for the mountaintop experience. And that's why we go to the mountains. We actually want to go and have an experience that is amazing. Sometimes these mountaintop experiences can turn into, and we hope, mountaintop seasons, right? Wouldn't we like to be in a season? I remember when I was studying through Joshua, one of the things that I didn't mention to you is there was a section in Joshua where after all this fighting, it said that there was a time when the thought of war didn't even enter into anyone's mind. There was just a season of peace. I'm looking for that. Anyone with me? Anyone been hanging around this church for the last 4 or 5 years? I'm looking for that. I'm looking for that, right? I am. A time of focus, of clarity in your focus of your life. A time when your finances are rocking, your relationships are kicking, you feel like you're out of the reach of trouble. A time when your faith is strong, you're hearing from God, your prayers are being answered, your problems are being solved, your tasks are being accomplished. It's a mountaintop season of life. Anyone ever had those? Anyone? Anyone? Some of us have. But that's a strong word, but. Like the song that we just heard. Sometimes things change. And ever wonder where God was when such and such happened? You could plug in your own thing. You ever hear anybody say that? Well, where was God when? You don't have to raise your hand, but probably some of us have said that same thing. Well, you know what? Things do change. We're not always having a mountaintop season or a mountaintop experience. Sometimes we drop down into the valley. Sometimes we do. And sometimes, much like a mountaintop experience turning into a season, our valleys can seem like a season as well, right? Anybody? Those mountains that once lifted us up and elevated us up, and it gave us that spot where we felt like we're on top of the world, now those same mountains seem to be the tasks and the challenges around us that are casting a dark and long shadow on our life. We feel like we're not hearing anything from heaven. Problems are overwhelming. Nothing good is going on. Hope is nowhere to be found. And like I said, these mountains, they seem like they're humongous, almost like you're in a cliff and it's piled up so high around you, you can't even see your way out of there. Anyone ever been in one of those seasons? Yeah. Well, listen, this is what I want to do. I believe that when you come to church, one of the tasks of the church is to help you understand who God is. If you know the nature, the person, the character of Almighty God, then and only then can you have an intimate, quality relationship with Him. So as these peaks and valleys of life go by, you can actually understand what's going on and survive and stand strong. If you don't know who God is, you can't have a good relationship with Him. And what I want to show you in God's Word is that the God of the Bible is the God of the mountain and the God of the valley, and his presence can be experienced in both places. So we're going to talk over the next month or so, I'm going to talk about mountains and I'm going to talk about valleys. I'm going to talk about real, actual mountains, like some Bible stories where they were actually on mountains, right? And sometimes we're going to go down into the valley of dry bones, where it's kind of rough, right? So we're going to talk about real mountains, real valleys, but what we want to see out of this is that there's proverbial mountains, there's proverbial valleys that you live in. We may not be up on Mount Sinai. We might not be up on Mount Carmel. We might not be up watching the transfiguration with Jesus, but there's lessons to be learned on the mountain just like there's lessons to be learned in the valley. So this is what I want to do first. I want to show you a mountaintop experience just so you can understand what I'm talking about. Do me a favor and go to Exodus chapter 19. Exodus chapter 19 is one of the greatest stories in all of Scripture. It's one of the greatest stories of a mountaintop experience. Moses is interacting literally with God himself. They've left Egypt. He's at Mount Sinai, and this guy Moses is an amazing man, and God has given him the privilege to actually go up onto the mountain, climbs up the mountain, and interacts with the living God, And so this is what happened. It's the title of this section in this Bible. It just says, the Lord reveals himself at Sinai. He reveals himself to Moses. He reveals himself to the people. I'm just going to kind of touch on some of the highlights, just kind of skim through this real quick. It says, 2 months after the Israelites left Egypt, they arrived at Sinai. They break camp here, and they set up camp there. And then Moses climbs, in verse 3, he climbs the mountain to appear before God. The Lord called to him from the mountain and said, give these instructions to the family of Jacob. Announce it to the descendants of Israel. This is what he wants to say. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians. You know how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own special treasure from among all the peoples on earth. For all the earth belongs to me, and you will be my kingdom of priests, my holy nation. Pardon me, I have a cold starting, so pardon me. It's better than what I normally do, right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Now, I just want to point out some things about this little conversation that's going on here with God and Moses. We're talking about mountaintop experience when things are going well, right? So here he is on the mountain, and look at some of the things that go on here. First and foremost, God is there. Right? God is there. He goes up on the mountain to appear before God. So God is there present with him on the mountain. Then it says that the Lord called to him. So God is speaking. And how many people want that when you pray and you so desperately want God to speak back to you? Let me give you a little bit of a hint. Shut up. That's free. If you shut up, he'll talk. Okay, so it says that God is there. God is speaking. And then it goes on, and I'll say this. God encourages on the mountain. It says, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians. You know how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. So what he's saying is he's encouraging them by reminding them that even though you get in a tough spot, I'm the God who did this. Remember what I did for you? Remember. Think back. Don't let your memory be so short, because we all like that. God delivers, and then some challenge comes, and we just forget what he did, and we start stressing out about it. Anybody? Don't leave me hanging. I'm not the only one. Every one of you does this. Every one of you, right? So God encourages, but he also does this, and this is huge. He gives you identity. You need to know who you are, and he tells them who they are. He says to them, he uses words like this, you'll be my own special treasure among all the peoples of the earth, and you'll be my kingdom of priests, my holy nation. That's who you are, people. That's who you are. God speaks to him on the mountain. So we know that he's there. He's on the mountain, right? So he is the God of the mountain. We know that. We see it right there in the text. It's clear. You can't argue it. But will God's people suffer defeat because he isn't the God of the valley? See, that's the question. Will they suffer defeat? Well, I'd like to do something. You saw Moses interact with God on the mountain. You see how God interacts with his people. It's a mountaintop experience, which was amazing. And then he gives them the Ten Commandments, as if that wasn't enough, right? But I want to introduce you to someone who was in the valley, but still experienced God. His name is Nehemiah. Oh boy. If you've been around this church for a while, you know when we talk about Mr. Nehemiah, things get a little silly up in here. I don't know what it is about this book. I'll be brief, so the trouble will be brief. Nehemiah chapter 1, right? Here's the deal with Nehemiah. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I just want you to know what's going on. There's this Jewish guy, Nehemiah, and Persia has taken over. Everyone's taken over Israel all the time. These poor folks. Everyone's always coming and taking over. So this is what happens. This guy, Nehemiah, he is the cupbearer for this King of all kings. Anyone ever seen the movie 300? That dude. You know, with the piercings, the crazy, powerful, like if you look at me wrong, I'll kill you. That guy? This guy's the cupbearer for him. So if someone's going to poison that king, he's going down because he's going to drink it first. Like, that's not a really good job. Is it? Right? That would suck. really. That's what it is, okay? So if you think your job is bad, just know that you have a better job than him. He loses his job when he dies. Not when you don't show up. Although if you don't show up, you'd definitely be dead. So this is what happens. This is a Jewish guy, right? And he goes up to the king. Now, he is absolutely in the proverbial valley. This is what's going on. The city that he loves is destroyed. Jerusalem's gates have been burned. The walls have been destroyed. Everything is destroyed. Everything that he knows, his whole history, his whole family, everything he holds sacred is destroyed. How many people love America, right? Can you imagine if an enemy came in here and just went to Washington, D.C. and just bulldozed the Capitol, you know what I'm saying, the white, all these things that are important to us, and just destroyed it. And they were in control of our country. And here we are. We're Americans. We love our country. And all of a sudden, it's just gone. Like, that would stink, wouldn't it? Honestly. So this is what's going on in Nehemiah's life. So this is what, let me read, starting verse 3. This is what happens. He gets a report from Jerusalem, and this is the report. Things are not going well for those who return to the province of Judah. They are in great trouble and disgrace, for the walls of Jerusalem have been torn down and the gates have been destroyed by fire. When I heard this, I sat down and wept. In fact, for days I mourned, fasted, and prayed to the God of heaven. He goes on, the end of verse 6, he confesses that all of the people, including his own family, have been sinning against God. You can feel his pain. He doesn't feel good about it. It says he was in verse 11, it says he was the king's cupbearer. And then the king brings him before him. Now remember, this king could kill you if you look at him wrong. If you're in a bad mood before him, he could kill you and have every right to do so. He's the king. And so the king brings him before him to ask, you know, what's going on? He says, why do you look so sad? Verse 2 of chapter 2. Why do you look so sad? You don't look sick to me. You must be deeply troubled. So he's deeply troubled. It says, I was terrified, this guy said. I was terrified. So here we are on Sinai, and things are going good. God's speaking. God's encouraging. God's giving you your identity. He's given him the Ten Commandments. Everything's good. Well, here's Nehemiah. And he's not in a valley per se, but he's in a proverbial valley. Listen to what's going on in his life. Things aren't going well. Trouble, disgrace. I'm weeping. I'm mourning. I'm sinning like crazy, and I'm admitting it. I don't feel good. I have a crappy job, and I'm scared because this guy might kill me. Would you agree? He's kind of in a valley. He's kind of in a valley. I'm going to read the rest of the story at the end. But let me just say this. On the mountaintop, God has a way of elevating us up on top, where we have this bird's eye view and we feel like we're on top of things. And the mountains actually are used to, God used them to lift us up, to literally lift us up on top of everything so we feel like we're a king. And the proverbial mountain does the same thing. When things are going well, we're hearing from God. All the areas of our life are prospering, and we're hearing from the Lord, and tasks are being accomplished, and problems are falling away, and our relationships are healthy, and there's tons of money in the bank. Everything's going good. So those proverbial mountains have a way of lifting us up as well. But like I said before, the song says, but things change. But things change. And now that same mountain that lifted us up and gave you this like dominant perspective over things, now it towers over you and casts a dark shadow over you, and it makes you kind of feel defeated sometimes. Anyone ever been there? Anyone? Anyone? Well, I have. And sometimes those valleys, they're not just a quick stay in a motel overnight, are they? Sometimes they turn into extended stay America. And we can't seem to get out of them. Well, I want to ask you guys a question. Honestly, will you let me love you tonight? Will you let me love on you tonight? Anybody let me? You got to say yes, so I can't go on. Honestly, you let me love you. Josh, you want a hug? Come here. I love you. I love you. Thank you. I asked you a question. If you guys were going on vacation to the mountains, and you're in your car, and you're going, you know, you ever been up there like this, right? And you're going down the road, and I knew that around the next bend there was sand on the road and the guardrail was gone. What would be the best way I could love on you? Warn you, right? Warn you that there was danger up ahead. Well, that's exactly what God's word does. And I want to share that with you. I'm going to share some stuff with you from the Bible that's going to give you some warnings. If you are aware that things are coming, you'll be better prepared to deal with them. And you'll be able to better be prepared to deal with valley experiences and seasons and know that they are beautiful and they are God-ordained and that God will meet you there. And it's actually beneficial. Let me just give you a story that, like, I don't want to get into the details of it because it would take weeks to tell you the story of Jesus, right? I can't tell you the story of Jesus in one little story, but here's the thing. Jesus is the Son of God who came away to take the sins of man away, and he's going to be the king of all of us, right? An eternal king forever, right? And so he's like rocking through Israel, and everyone's starting to follow him. He's getting big crowds, and he's healing people, and he's famous, and things are going well, right? And so what's happening? The devil's probably going, man, what's going on here? It's starting to work. And then what happens? He gets put up on a cross. He gets stretched and whipped and beaten and murdered and put into a grave. And so what's the devil going? Ha ha, we got him now, right? You know it. But what happens? See, the Holy Spirit comes to the party and raises Jesus from the dead. And so God looks at the devil and says, you ain't got nothing. See, that's the valley. When Jesus was in the grave, God did his greatest work by raising him from the valley. That's ultimate victory. Can someone say amen? Amen. Yeah. I need to see you guys get a little excited, man. God uses valleys, everybody. Nobody wants to be in the valley, but that's where God will meet you. Look at your neighbor and say, don't waste a valley. Come on. Don't waste a valley, man. Don't waste a valley. You're going to be in them. Like I said, you're either in one, you just come out of one, or you're heading for one. But they're coming, and don't waste the valley. Don't waste the valley, and don't think that your life is going to be up on top of the mountain all the time, or you're sadly mistaken, and you are going to be crushed. You will be crushed. Listen, I'm about to reference Psalm 23. Anyone ever heard of Psalm 23? Though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I just saw a picture online. I just thought it was kind of funny. I just thought I would share this with you. Check out, I thought that was kind of funny. Has no spiritual value whatsoever, but it's kind of funny. Let me ask you all a question. Psalm 23, why can David say, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, some translations will say, even though I walk through the darkest of valleys, I shall not fear. How can he say that? See, God knows. I mean, I'm sorry, David knows something. He has a little secret. He's got a secret, and God wants you guys to know the secret so you can be just like him. So let me tell you what it is. I told you I wanted to love on you, right? When you're in the valley, the mountains that once lifted you up, like I said, they seem to be towering over you and casting a big shadow over you, and everything is dark and gloomy and bad. And so you start getting intimidated, and you feel cornered, right? But God's word has some warnings. Warning, 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 right? Listen to this one, you ready? Psalm 34:19. It says that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them all. You're the righteous ones. When you said yes to Jesus, his righteousness is now yours, and you will have afflictions. See, if you think that if you can become a Christian, oh, everything's great, woo! Everyone's Joel Osteen with a smile. I love Joel. But I'm just saying, it's not. Listen, he looks like everything's rocking all the time, but we all know better. It's not rocking all the time. Sometimes it's awful. And so God's word tells you, listen, many are the afflictions of the righteous. When you become a Christian, some people think this false idea, everything's going to be great. So when things don't go great, you start going, well, is there anything to this, Jesus? Because someone told me things were going to get better. He said I'd have an abundant life. Why did my tire just pop on the way to work? Why didn't Jesus put air in it for me? Why didn't he do that? I mean, I'm a Christian now. Things are good. Well, listen, the Bible, you know why I love the Bible? You know why I know our faith is real? Because the stuff in here that stinks. It's like cold, hard truth. Oh, wait a minute. I want you to have my religion. I'm going to tell you everything's great. But Jesus is like, no, things aren't always going to be great. Join my party. I don't want to join that party. It's so brutal and true. I love God's word. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them from them all. From them all. Why? Because when you're in the valley, when you're in the valley and you're hurting and scared and you're challenged and despair sets in this darkness, you're not on the mountaintop and it feels like God is absent. God doesn't know. Darkness is overwhelming. But see, that's the opposite of the truth. That's the opposite of the truth. If you go to the verse just before that, 34:18, it says this. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and he rescues those whose spirits are crushed. Yeah. That's just something. Listen, it seems like we're on top of the mountain, that God is near. And listen, he is. I get it. But the truth is that there's something in the heart of Almighty God that drives him to the person in the valley that's crying out to him, that feels hopeless, that is completely brokenhearted. Things have collapsed and I feel like I can't get out. And God rushes to that person who's crying out to him. Isaiah 59:1 says that his ear is not too deaf to hear those who cry out to him. That's our God. That's our God. So here we get another one. Warning, warning, warning. You ready for another warning? John 16:33. In this life, you will have problems. You will be in the valley. You will have trials. But take heart, for I have overcome the world, Jesus said. He's like, yeah. He said, yeah, don't half-heart this thing. If you're going to clap for Jesus, let's get it on. Yeah. So he says, listen, in this life, you're going to have problems. I get it. Jesus is not like pulling out a surprise on you. He's telling you right here, it's not always going to seem hunky-dory. It's not always going to be bunny rabbits and unicorns. Things are going to be rough sometimes. But take heart. See, he says, I know. He says, I rush into the brokenhearted. He knows you're brokenhearted. He knows how sad you are. He knows how down in the dumps you are. He knows how fearful you are. He knows how scared you are. And so what does he say? Take heart. I like to think that Jesus is going, take my heart. Take my heart. Your heart's busted. You can't fix this, but I can. Take a hold of my heart. Woo, 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 woo. Warning, warning, warning. You ready for another warning? Jesus wants to tell you what's up so you won't be caught off guard, so you won't fall into the valley and fall on your face. 1 Peter 4:12. This is so clear. 1 Peter 4:12. Dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials you are going through as if something strange were happening to you. Again, just because you bend the knee to Jesus and he becomes your Lord and Savior, and he secured your spot in glory forever, and he's right by your side. I get it. But that doesn't mean the promise is that everything's going to go well. You need to understand that you're going to be in some valleys sometimes. But he'll meet you there. He'll meet you there. Don't be surprised by this. Don't be surprised that when you go around the corner that the guardrail is down. Don't be surprised at the sand on the road. Don't be surprised when your car breaks down. Don't be surprised when your friend lets you down. Don't be surprised when your church lets you down. Don't be surprised when your government lets you down. Don't be surprised when your kids let you down. Things are going to let you down. Don't be surprised. This is the way, the life of the Christian. But the great thing for us is that we have a God who loves us, and he will meet you right there, and he'll walk with you right through that trial. You don't have to do it alone. And the challenge for us is to embrace that and show the world the greater life when you are walking with a Savior who created the heavens and the earth rather than walking through cancer and divorce and failure on your own, weeping, crying, don't know what to do. The one who's got the Jesus, the creator of the universe with him, he can stand strong because he knows all things are going to work out for him. There's a big difference. There's a big difference. He wants to use your valley. He wants to use your valley to build your faith, to increase your trust, to lengthen your patience, to build your character, to increase and better your integrity. God's not wasting a valley ever, ever. Do me a favor, here comes another warning. You ready for another warning? Go to the book of James, chapter 1. Once again, Jared has it memorized. Why don't you go ahead and tell us what it says? Oh, okay. Yeah. So this is the stuff that a lot of churches won't talk about, but it's the truth, and if you know God, you can be prepared when the valleys come. Wouldn't you? What if you were under the impression that everything was going to be absolutely hunky-dory perfect once you became saved? How, game over. First thing that happens, you're like, is there even a God? Is he listening to me? Is he aware of what's going on? My life is a wreck, and I don't see anyone. I don't see any angels appearing in my bedroom. Like, what's going on? I don't see the mystery check coming to my mail. But why? Is he even there? See, that's what happens. If you don't know who God is, you're not going to rightly divide him, if you will. You're not going to understand who he is so you can get through some stuff. So here's James, Jesus' brother. And let me tell you, who's got brothers in here? How many of you could convince your brother that you were God? Yeah. So in other words, he is. Now, it would take a strong argument, right, to convince your brother that you were the Lord. Right? When you're growing up with your brothers and you're picking on each other and fighting and stealing toys, that would take a strong argument to be convinced that that brother was the creator. So I just throw that in there. There was a freebie. So here we are in James chapter 1. James chapter 1. Look at what it says here in verse 2. Dear brothers and sisters. So who's he talking to? Us. Brothers and sisters in Christ. Us. The family. Not to non-believers. This is to you. If you've accepted Christ, this is a gift to you. There's some promise in here too from the Creator. Kind of bank on it. Just saying. He's got a good resume. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles come your way, they will, consider it an opportunity for great joy. Now, hold on a second. I wouldn't write that. Who would write that? If you were starting a religion, who would write that? No. It doesn't make any sense, does it? I don't want that. I want my people to think there's going to be trouble. I want them to think everything's going to be great, so they'll keep coming. Honest, brutal honesty of Scripture, and that's why I know that it's real. Consider it an opportunity for great joy. I've always struggled with this, and I'm probably not alone. For you know that when your faith is tested, troubles, valley or mountain? Valley or mountain? Anyone else? Valleys, mountain, yeah, valleys, yeah. Yeah, if you fall off a top mountain, you're going to end up in a... Yeah, okay. For you know when your faith is tested, your endurance... And also, we know that it's kind of valley because he equates it with troubles, right? Faith is tested, troubles. Endurance, when your faith is tested, when you have troubles, your endurance has a chance to grow. Strengthening your faith, right? Strengthening your relationship with the Lord. And I love this. I love the Bible, man. And God never beats around the bush, right? He's like, it has an opportunity for endurance to grow. So let it grow, you stubborn thing. Let it grow, right? It's like Paul in Romans 12. He's like, brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies as a living sacrifice. Consider all that he's done for you. Isn't that the least you could do? Just brutal honesty. And so it's the same thing here. When troubles come your way and I'm going through it and you're in the valley, God's going to use it to let your endurance grow. So let it grow. And sometimes we're just so obstinate and stubborn like we're children. And you're telling your kid, don't do this anymore. It's not bad for you. And they're just holding on to it, white knuckling. I like my sin. It's like Tommy Boy. I like my little. You guys, some of you know what I'm talking about. I like my little deal. And you don't want to let go of it. And God's like, yeah, you stubborn children, let me work on you. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, like when he matures you, and your faith is strong, and your patience is long, and your integrity is there, and your character is deep, like Christ, Listen to this. This is good. You will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. Yeah, needing nothing. God is not going to waste a valley. Not going to waste a valley. So, let's go back to Psalm 23 for a second. Not to the chicken picture, but to our Psalm 23, the real Psalm 23 for you. Why is it that David can say, although I walk through the darkest of valleys, the valley of the shadow of death, I shall not fear? Why? Because he is with me. See, when you walk, that's yet again more evidence. When you walk through the valley and it's scary and you're overwhelmed, Gunhammer, what's up? And you're overwhelmed and you think that those mountains that used to stand on give you this strong perspective over everything, dominating perspective over everything, now they're on top of you and you feel the weight of them on top of you, you feel scared and hopeless and discouraged. Know this. You cry out to the Lord and he comes rushing into your valley. He says, I will not fear even the darkest of valleys, the valley of the shadow of death, because you are with me. Because you are with me. You're not going to believe this. But in closing, I know. I only have 13 more chapters to read. In closing, I ask you, why was Nehemiah encouraged? Why was he encouraged and comforted in his valley of trouble and disgrace and weeping and mourning and sinning, and he was terrified that things were not going well? That type of valley. Why was he encouraged and comforted? Why was he encouraged and comforted? Will you look at verse 8 of the story in Nehemiah? It says that he went to the king and he said, my city's destroyed. You guys, you king, you destroyed my city. You're our enemy, right? And I would like for you to do me a favor. I'd like for you to give me all the building material that we need to rebuild the city that will oppose you. He says, and with a prayer to God, he confidently went up to this king who could have snapped his neck right then and there. And the king said, yes. Why? Because verse 8 says that the gracious hand of God was upon him. In the darkest, saddest valley anyone could experience, the hand of God was upon that man. And so if you're going through valley, just know his hand is on you as well. God hears the cries of his brokenhearted kids in the valley. He hears them, and he rushes in. And if you'll allow God to find you there in your valley, he'll rush in. Not only will he rush in, but he won't waste that valley. And he will teach you there. He will grow you there. See, that's where you're going to grow. When God said his desire in Romans 8, 29, that we would be conformed into the image of Christ, How did Christ sum up? Listen, don't email me if you think I'm saying this wrong, but how did Christ mature? How did he come to his fullness? He suffered. And we are to share in his suffering, because in those suffering times, in those suffering seasons, that's where God will grow you. Not everyone lives on top of the mountain all the time. And if you're looking for that, you're looking for the wrong God. Because he's the God of the mountain and he's the God of the valley. He hears your valley cry and he rushes in and he won't waste a mountain. So, some of us are on a mountain right now and some of you are in a valley. I don't know. I know some of you, and I know some of you are on mountains and I know some of you are on valleys. I know, I hear the stories. So here's the thing. If you're on a mountain, you could take a few minutes as we pass out communion. You could take a few minutes and you can thank him for that experience. You know, when you're on the mountaintop physically, when you go to the Carolinas and Tennessee and all that stuff, and you're on the mountain and you're staring out onto this amazing splendor and you're like, wow. See that same God that's there? He's here right now. That freaks me out. but you can thank him for your mountaintop experience. You can thank him for your mountaintop season that you're in right now. I just have a strange feeling, just because I live with you guys, that some of you are in some valleys, right? Yeah. But listen, just like Nehemiah, fear, mourning, sin that makes you sad and feel like crap because you do it, sadness, worry, everything you hold precious has been ruined, just like Nehemiah. Maybe for Nehemiah it was a city, but maybe it's for you it's a relationship, maybe it's your career. Maybe you were at another church and they just crushed you and you feel so devastated that when you were used to go to that place and it seemed like you're on top of the world and everyone loved each other, and all of a sudden those people that loved you, they were preying on you and you feel like you're almost dead. I don't know. But maybe you can be like Nehemiah and you can just cry out to your Father. So the promise of the scriptures, the true God is a God who rushes in to his children when they're crying out to him. And I don't know about you, but if you have never got on your knees, literally got on your knees and soaked your floor with tears, you have never really met with God. That is a meeting that I beg you all to have. And when you get on the ground and you're weeping and crying, and listen, I've been on my motorcycle and I have cussed him out like crazy because that was what was really going inside of me. That's what he wants to know. He wants to know what's going on in your heart and just cry out to him and ask him for help. And the Bible says that he will rush to you. If you come to him, by no means will he turn you away, the Gospel of John says. It also says if you draw close to him, he will draw close to you. He will draw close to the brokenhearted and he rescues those. I'm sorry, that he are crushed in spirit. And he rushes in to rescue those that are brokenhearted. That's our God. And I beg you now to cry out to him and know that he's there. You're not alone as you go through this season. He is there with you right now. I'm going to ask you to take a few moments and do that. And I need some gentlemen to pass out the communion elements. And then I'll come back and I'll lead you in taking communion together as a family. Thank you.
Matchless in every way.
God rushes in to those who cry out to him, and his ear is not too deaf to hear the cries of his people. As they were starting to sing, I was reminded of something in the scriptures and something I'd already shared with you, and I was like, man, yes, that all these promises of God are to his people, to you, to if you're a believer. You know, he doesn't waste valleys for believers. Trust in him. He'll come, he'll rush in, and he'll help you. But I started thinking about something. It was just, I just want to bring you there. There was a day, and I don't know everybody, their heart in this room, I don't know. But I know most of you. There was a day that you cried out to the Lord. He heard your voice. And he came rushing in and he saved you. That was an awesome day. I remember that day for me. It was a great day and I was just giddy, you know? That's just what I want to take you back there. Just take a moment to think about that. When you cried out to the Lord and you realized that you needed a Savior, you couldn't do it alone. Your life was just a mess. You kept trying different things and kept failing, couldn't find joy, couldn't find any happiness, couldn't find any prosperity in anything you were trying. And finally, someone came to you and told you about this Jesus fella. And you just cried out to him. You said, Lord, I believe. I need you to help me. And that is the greatest gift that you've been given. The free gift of God, which is eternal life through Christ. And I just want to take you back to that moment when you realize that what he did on the cross at Calvary was for you. When that big pile of sin, you lumped it onto him and he said, I will take it gladly because I love you. And he forgave you of your sin and he secured a spot in glory forever. What a privilege. And because of that, then we get to enjoy the privilege of God working on us in the valley. Then we get to enjoy the fact that we can cry out as a child to our Father, and our Father will rush to our help in our valley. It's because Jesus gave us that privilege. And that all started on the cross. And so we want to take a moment to remember that, to remember the broken body of Jesus, the Jesus that willingly laid down his life that you might live. So let's take the bread to remember that. God's not going to walk away. He made a covenant with you. He said, I will love you, I forgive you, I will keep you, I will have you forever. And that covenant was signed with the blood of his son, Jesus. Without the shedding of blood, the Bible says, there's no forgiveness of sin. And so Jesus Christ shed his blood so you don't have to. And that's what's represented by the drink. Take it in remembrance of him.